Let's look at how to add a hidden watermark into an image. And I've got an image here, and I'm adding a standard watermark. And here we can see the letters across the image, and I've achieved this by raising the intensity level of the pixels that correspond to the letters in the image. And so this is a visible watermark. But how are we going to think about hiding a watermark in an image? Well, we're going to have to think about looking in a different domain, a transform domain. Let's think about the two-dimensional Fourier transform. And for more information about Fourier transforms, check out the description below. You'll find lots of links on the channel to videos on Fourier transforms, including the two-dimensional Fourier transform. And what we can see is that in this transform domain, you get a lot of energy for this image around the center, up to 3.5 by 10 to the 5, and the values out on the edges are very low. So let's think about whether those values really matter for the image. So I'm going to zoom in onto that picture that we just saw. And here we are showing all the values that are less than 50. And we can see that lots of the transform area corresponds to values very small, 50, much less than 3.5 by 10 to the 5. And so let's look at a top view of this to see how much area this corresponds to. And really it's all of this blue area around here. So those values are very, very small. And it leads you to wonder, are they actually important for the image? And if they're not really that important for the image, perhaps we can put a watermark there. We can vary them and we can do it in a way that's not going to be detectable. So to sort of test this out, I'm going to set all of those values that are less than 50 to 0. That's what I've done here. And if we go back to the image domain, let's see what effect that had on the image of removing all those values, just to test out that kind of idea. And here's the image that you get. So really, there's no discernible difference. I'm showing here a highlighted version of the actual difference between the original image and the one that had all those components in the frequency domain zeroed out. And so there is an actual difference, but I've really highlighted it here. It's really not very much in terms of the actual pixel values. Here's a histogram that shows that the intensity level of change is on the x-axis and the y-axis is the number of pixels that underwent that change. And so although 69% of the pixels in the image were modified, having had all of those other ones zeroed out, all of in the frequency domain, but they weren't modified by very much. They were modified maybe 1, 2, 3, up to 5 intensity levels out of the 256 possible intensity levels. So it's really not discernible. Getting rid of all of those values, those low-level values in the Fourier transform domain, didn't really change the image very much. So let's think about putting a watermark in the frequency domain. So here's a watermark, and if we add it to the Fourier transform of the image, then this is what we get here. So that's the Fourier transform of the image plus the watermark in the frequency domain. Let's convert this back to the image domain and see if this adding this watermark makes any discernible difference. Have we managed to hide it? And here's the image, the watermarked image. You really can't tell that there's been a watermark applied. So we might think that this is a success and that we've achieved our goal. So here's the differences in the image domain. In this case, the differences are out near the corners of the image. So that's something that's interesting and might affect us. We're going to come back and look at that just in a little bit. But when we go back into the frequency domain, we don't recover our original image. And this is concerning, because we were expecting just to see the image transform plus the watermark that we'd added. But we can see that the watermark's there, but we can see other versions. We've got an upside down version here, for example. So what's going on? And what we need to realize is that in the frequency domain, if you have an image in the image domain that's real valued, then in the frequency domain, the transform is going to be symmetric. It's going to be complex symmetric. And when we added that watermark, we got a little bit excited and just thought we can add any watermark. It's not the case. We have to pick watermarks that are symmetric, and that one wasn't. So let's pick a watermark that's symmetric and see if now we've solved the problem. So now we've got a symmetric version of that other watermark. Let's see if this is going to be able to be put into the image in such a way that when we take our watermarked image and go back into the frequency domain, we recover the watermark. And here's the watermarked image with the symmetric watermark now. And in the image domain, we can't see that that's there, just like with the other one, so that's good. Now, where are the differences? Very similar, they're in the corners of the image, just like it was before, but it reaches out a little bit more into the image. And let's see what happens when we transfer back into the frequency domain, we recover our watermark. So we've solved that problem by making sure that our watermark is complex symmetric. And then we've got a hidden watermark in our image. But maybe that's not everything that we want to achieve. We've got the watermark there, it's hidden, but we want it to be hidden even if the image gets manipulated. And one of the most common things in images is cropping the image. So will our watermark survive a cropping? And perhaps it won't, because we saw that the difference between the two images were out near the corners. So let's see that. So I've now taken a cropped version of the image where I've taken off 10% around all the sides. So we've now removed the outside parts of the image, and let's see what happens in the frequency domain now. So we've got our watermarked image, we've cropped it. If we go back into the frequency domain, we are hoping to see the watermark, but in fact the watermark has been completely removed. We can't tell that the watermark is there. And that was because our watermark in the frequency domain, when it went into the image domain, it was changing pixels out near the corners of the image. And they get cropped off if you crop the image, and cropping is a very common thing that people do to images. So we want to pick a watermark that's going to be resistant to the cropping. It needs to be symmetric, but it also needs to be resistant to the cropping. So let's try a different watermark. Here's a square grid watermark. Let's see if that is going to be satisfactory. Here it is over the top of the image. If we go back into the image domain, sure, we can't tell that the watermark is there, so it's hidden, which is great. Where are the differences? There appear to be no differences, at least none that show up on this picture. Actually, there are differences. They turn out to be around the edges of the image. When we go back into the frequency domain, we recover the watermark, which is what we want to see, but let's do this test about the cropping. We now crop our image, and when we go back into the frequency domain, again, the watermark has totally been removed. So that square grid watermark, which affected the edges of the image, is not a good watermark. Let's try a different one. Let's try a circular watermark. Here it is on the image in the frequency domain. We go to the image domain. We can't see the effect of the watermark, just like with the other ones, which is excellent. The difference is still out near the corners though. So changing to a circular watermark doesn't actually help. Here it is back in the frequency domain. It survives the transform forwards and backwards, which is great. But when we crop it, we're going to see that the watermark again doesn't survive the cropping. If you really look carefully, you can see that in this case, in the frequency domain, you can just make out some arcs in the frequency domain, which sort of which correspond to the watermark. It hasn't completely been removed, but still it's not showing up in a way that's going to be able to be easily seen, and it's not what we want. So we need a different one. So let's try this square grid on an angle. Let's see if that makes a difference. Here it is over the top of the image, and let's see when we transfer back into the image domain, whether that affects our image. No, it doesn't. No discernible change to the image. It's definitely hidden. When we look at the difference, we see a different thing compared to the other watermarks that we've looked at. The other ones, if you remember, the difference between the image and the watermarked image were out near the corners of the image. But now, might be a bit hard to see, but now the difference is an X. There's a cross of different pixels. So again, this is the difference image in the image domain. And we're seeing now that pixels on the diagonals have been changed. And that is an important difference to the other ones. So that in this case, if we now crop this image, then we're not going to be cropping off the effect of the watermark. The watermark will still be having an effect through the center of the image. So here it is, if we just take the Fourier transform back and we see the watermark, of course, for the full image as we have before, which is what we wanted to see. Now, when we crop this image, with the square grid on an angle, in the frequency domain, we still see the watermark. So this is a really crucial, important difference to the other watermarks that we looked at, where they were symmetric, which was good. That was important to recover it for the full image. But in this case, we can also recover it for a cropped image, which was not the case for the other watermarks. So this then gives you some insights into what other types of watermarks you could use. You can design any sort of watermark that you want, apply it in the frequency domain. It'll, as long as you keep the values low, below 50, in this particular case for this image, below 50, it meant that it was indetectable when you look back in the image domain. But you want to make sure that you're picking a watermark which affects all of the image in the image domain, not just the corners and edges, just like this cross-hashed watermark did. So if you found this video helpful, give it a thumbs up. It helps others to find the video. Of course, subscribe to the channel for more videos, and that's helpful for the channel as well. And as I said before, check out the description below. You'll find a web page which has a full categorized listing of all the videos on the channel. And if you'd like to help me out making these videos, you might consider joining the channel. You can hit the join button below the video. It'd be much appreciated.